Kate Winslet is here. She is a four-time Oscar nominee with four films in theaters this fall. Two of the films, All the King's Men and Little Children, are in theaters now. Here's a look at those films.
How's your wife? I'm sorry, I've forgotten her name.
That didn't quite work out as I'd hoped. A lot of tangled bedclothes and unspoken loathing, then spoken loathing and no tangled bedclothes. Didn't I read of your engagement in the society column? Which, you know, I always turn to first in the paper.
I was engaged more than once. Adam didn't care for any of them. Though why that should matter, I don't know.
Who needs them anyway?
So how was your weekend?
You really want to know? It sucked. How was yours?
Terrible.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, we went to the beach, and all Kathy and I did was argue the whole time.
You did?
Yeah, it was our annual argument over taking the bar exam, like our whole life depends on it.
Get it over with, you'll feel better.
That's this whole thing. Gotta take a train on Wednesday, and it's a two-day ordeal. I'm not even gonna pass.
You'll be fine.
No. No, I won't. I haven't cracked a book all summer.
Later this fall, she will lend her voice to the animated Flushed Away. She'll also appear in the romantic comedy The Holiday with Jack Black. I am pleased to have her back at this table. Welcome back.
Thank you very much.
Also, Jude Law is in.
Jude Law is in The Holiday also. Yeah, he plays my brother. Yes, he does.
Where do I start? How are you?
I'm very well. I'm very, very well indeed.
The wonderful husband, Sam Mendes, has a great play coming up that everybody in New York can't
he
wait
does.
To see.
He does. David has the Vertical Hour with Bill Nye and Julianne Moore. Yeah. And, yeah, we're very well, very, very
You're
well.
You're working hard, or you have been working hard.
I
all
have,
these
I mean,
films
it's, yeah, it's sort of, I suppose it does look like I've been, you know, insanely ambitious and working a lot in the last few years, but the truth is, everything that's coming out in this four-month period of time is pretty much everything I've done since my son was born, and he's nearly three now. So it's just coming out now, you know, and as actors, you have no control over any of that. You have no say whatsoever. But you know, the nice thing is that, you know, particularly with little children, I love the film so much. It's such a pleasure to sort of talk about it and find something new to say about it all the time. And
you're talking about this one.
I'm talking about little children, yeah.
We talked to Todd Field, your director.
Yep.
Tell me about your character, Sarah.
Well, I play Sarah. Sarah is a very intelligent woman. She is a woman who was a feminist when she was younger. She's very feisty. You imagine that if she weren't leading the life she's leading, that she would have probably been some great philosopher or adventurer of some kind. But that's not what's happened to her life. She's living in suburbia. She doesn't quite know how she's ended up living there. She's married to a man. She doesn't really know why she married him. She's not in love with him anymore.
No one knows why she married him.
No, no one knows. No one knows why she married him. But I think it was just a moment of extreme loneliness and weakness on her part. And she has a small child, a three-year-old daughter, who she doesn't have a particular connection with this child. She's not a very good parent. She doesn't really know how to be a mother. So what you have is a woman who has ended up living a life that she just did not plan for herself at all. And she's incredibly unhappy. And having to sort of mask that and cover that up just in order to survive and get through every day. She's extremely trapped and lonely and is wanting to break free and wants something more in her life. And she finds it in Brad, played by Patrick Wilson, who
more
she meets
in Brad in a moment.
Playground.
Do you think there are a lot of women like this? Do you know a lot of women like this?
I do know women like this,
have
yeah.
all this talent. And are interesting and smart, and many of them are sort of in love with the idea of their children and being the greatest parent they can be. Others like you find a way to do both of it. And then you have a feeling that there are some, like this character Sarah,
Yeah.
Who somehow is in conflict because of it and can't find the way to make it all work.
Well, I think she's, you know, she's lost control of her life and herself and who she is. She can't remember who she once was, and she's desperately trying to get back to that person, but she's forgotten who that person was in the first place. And I think the truth is I do know women like this, you know, and I overhear conversations in the playground myself, very similar to the conversations that you hear in this movie, in the playground by the swing set with the other mothers. You know, it was difficult to play somebody who, you know, on the surface is nothing like me, but in actual fact, through shooting this film and playing this character and understanding who she was, I think I realised that in actual fact, there's so much of her that has been me at various different times of my life. You know, Sarah's very much the, you know, she's not necessarily a beauty. She doesn't have particularly good dress sense. She has absolutely terrible hair, so on and so forth. And she's the kind of girl who didn't get asked to dance at the prom, you know. And the truth is, I was like that. I never, you know, I never got the boys. I was never thought of as pretty or attractive or anything like that. And, you know, was nervous of life in many ways, and I think that's a lot of Sarah too. And so it was just interesting in terms of building who she was and the preparation that I was doing for myself. I kept coming up with things where I'd go, okay, I might not like to admit this, but in actual fact, yeah, I've been there. I've been that person. I've felt emotionally stifled like she feels in this film, and it was hard to sort of revisit some of that stuff in myself.
But also good, I assume, because it gave you some place to access something that you could
It did in a strange way. It was kind of weirdly therapeutic, I think, even though I didn't necessarily realise that at the time. It's kind of only now talking about it that I kind of go, oh, yeah, OK, I got that out of my system then, maybe. But it was an enormous challenge.
When you say there was a time in which you weren't very attractive and you didn't have a date at the prom, a lot of people are saying, oh, sure. She's just
I'm telling you.
Did you actually?
I'm telling you. I was a very, how do I put this? You know, I was a little bit...
Ugly duckling?
Very much an ugly duckling.
No,
I absolutely was. And, you know, I was a very stocky child. I was quite an overweight teenager. I was quite shy. I never got to go out with the cute boys, never. It's true. I mean, it's really
all
true.
So what happened to change it for you? How come you got smart?
I don't know. I grew up. I got brave. I started working as an actress, which I think is a huge confidence booster. You know, so much of acting is about having the confidence to really step out there and do it. You know, I think
to expose yourself.
Absolutely. And I think it's 50% skill and 50% confidence. Otherwise, you don't have a performance. You don't have the courage to put yourself there, to go to those extremes and play those parts. And it's a real test of emotional strength just to be an actress on its own, regardless of whether you're actually getting a job or not.
Do you think your life would have been very different if you hadn't been in Titanic?
I don't know. It's so hard to say. I mean, I definitely think that, without question, it opened so many doors for me in terms of opportunity and choice, you know, the freedom to choose what I do as an actress, which is such an extraordinary luxury. It really is, because I get to play so many different roles and so many different types of people. It's never the same, and I love that. I really do. It's part of the challenge, and it's part of what I love about this job. And I really do love this job, more so all the time, I think. But it's, yeah, I mean, it's likely that my life could have been very, very different. I don't know in what way.
Lots of people who have talent and skill, for whatever reason, luck, timing, it didn't come together at the right time.
Mm. Well, a classic example of that, actually, is there's an actor in Little Children. His name's Jackie Earle Haley, and he plays the character Ronnie, who is a convicted sex offender. Right. And he gives the most extraordinary performance. I mean, you feel nothing but incredible pain and sympathy for this man. But Jackie Earle Haley, you know, he was living a whole other life down in San Antonio, hadn't worked as an actor for 16 years until Steve Zalian found him and cast him as Sugar Boy in All the King's Men. And then Todd Field turned to me and said, listen, what are your thoughts on Jackie Earle Haley? Didn't you work with him on All the King's Men? And I immediately said, Oh my God. I mean, he's not only one of the sweetest men I've ever met, but a wonderful actor and perfect casting for Ronnie. And he came in to New York and he came and auditioned, and I went up to the production offices and, and read in with him, and Todd gave him the part on the spot, right there and then. He turned to him and said, look, Jackie, do you want to do this? And this man, who had not worked and had gone through some seriously dark moments, I think, as an out-of-work actor, suddenly was given his life back again. And he burst into tears, grown man, burst into tears.
When he told him he had the part?
Yeah.
That's a great story.
It is a great story, and because I know Jackie, and I was so happy for him, I then burst into tears too, and it was a pretty incredible moment.
How do you think, you said it gets better and better. It gets better and better because confidence grows or skills grow or what?
You learn so much as an actor that you want to keep learning more and more, and I think the day that I sit up and say, oh, I know how to do this now, is really the day that I should consider stopping, because you can never know enough. You know, I would never claim to know everything about acting. It's not possible. And I feel I very much need direction and guidance from my director. And I absolutely had that with Todd Field. I mean, because he's an actor too, you know, his understanding of what the actor has to go through in order to, you know, go those emotional lengths and become that other person, the support and the sort of sense of your hand being held was so strong on this film, and it was a really wonderful collaboration. I mean, actors, you know, you hear that actors say that a lot, you know, this was a great collaboration and blah, 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 but it really was something else. You know, I'd have lots of late night telephone calls with Todd where he would suddenly call me and say, you know, have you looked at the scene for tomorrow? And I would say, well, yeah, obviously, of course. He said, well, what do you think? And I'd say, well, what do you mean, what do I think? He'd say, well, don't you think it's too long? And I would say, well, actually, since you ask, perhaps, you know, we could trim it down a little bit here and there. We say, well, how? Where? What should we do? What do you want to change? And I'd be like, me? Why are you asking me? I'm not a director.
Director has to have confidence to do that, too.
Yeah.
Because with some directors and some actors, they would take it, they would say to themselves, he doesn't know what he's doing.
Mm. Yeah. But he does so know what he's doing. I mean, and part of the actor's job, I think, well, certainly for me, is, you know, you have to put your trust in the director, and you have to basically do what they want you to do, you know. Even if sometimes you might quietly disagree, it's very much a part of the job to comply with the director's every wish. I really do feel like that. And, you know, luckily for me on this, you know, I agreed with so much of what Todd wanted all the time. And if I didn't know what to do sometimes in a scene, I also knew that I could turn to him and say, oh, give me an idea, help me. I'm, you know, I'm stuck, I don't know how to play this, just tell me. And he would always
have
come
a word
out with
or an idea.
These little gems that were so helpful.
What amazes me about acting is this, is that you could take two people, two very good, talented actors, same role, same script, and both of them could do it in their own way and different way, and both would be right, and both would be enjoyable. Mm-hmm. There is no right way.
No, there's no
to get inside a character.
No, but I think that, again, that's one of the things about acting that I love so much, is that there is no right or wrong, that you can, sometimes you can just play and play and play and just see what happens. And I think the sense of mystery that's involved in every single day of shooting is just so glorious. It really is so glorious. And you have to be confident and brave enough to make mistakes as well. You know, sometimes it's not always going to go according to plan. Sometimes you might do something that's just not very good, and you have to be brave enough to make that mistake in front of a crew of people who you, you know, barely know sometimes. And it's just all about experimenting, and we very much had that on Little Children, very much so.
Easier to do that on film than on the stage, because you can be edited on film.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, on film, at least you can stop in the middle and say, no, this is all going very badly. Let's just start again.
you can't do that on stage. The director can come back the next day.
Yeah. Yes. Exactly. You
know. Let me take a look. Here's a scene from The Little Children.
I think I understand your feelings about this book. I used to have some problems with it myself. When I read it in grad school, Madame Bovary just seemed like a fool. She marries the wrong man, makes one foolish mistake after another. But when I read it this time, I just fell in love with her. She's trapped. It's a choice. She can either accept a life of misery or she can struggle against it. And she chooses to struggle.
Some struggle. Hop into bed with every guy who says hello.
Well, she fails in the end, but there's something beautiful and even heroic in her rebellion. My professors would kill me for even thinking this, but in her own strange way, Emma Bovary is a feminist.
Oh, that's nice. So now cheating on your husband makes you a feminist?
No. It's not the cheating. It's the hunger. The hunger for an alternative. And the refusal to accept a life of unhappiness.
Maybe I didn't understand the book.
What happens to her here? There is a man who comes to the playground. Mm. He has his own life. We've seen a scene in the trailer. He's a little bit worried about the bar exam, which he hasn't passed. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have a great thing at home either.
Yep.
He's got a child.
Yep.
And all of a sudden, these two people who are missing something.
Yeah.
But it doesn't end like a fairy tale.
No, it doesn't, no. But, you know, how many things in life do, you know? And that's why that's something that I think is very unique about this film, is that it's very unafraid to just sort of talk about things that are harsh but true. And I love that about it. I think it's really quite powerful because of how real it is and because of how true to life I think it might feel to some people. What happens to Sarah is she's plodding along through life. She's accepting that this is just the way it's going to be. It's just a road to nowhere, and somehow she's just going to have to hang on to herself.
Sees no way out.
Sees absolutely no way out, and I think if she really thought about that as seriously as perhaps she would probably, you know, just run off alone and leave everybody behind. But she accepts it all. She puts on a brave face and she talks to these other mothers in the playground.
As we just saw,
that was one of them there, Marianne, who's one of the very strict mothers whose rigid adherence to snack times with her kids is rather horrifying. But they talk about this this guy, this attractive guy they've seen coming to the playground over the last few weeks, and they've taken to calling him the prom king because he reminds them of the prom king, and he is devastatingly handsome. And Sarah can't quite believe how giddy they are over this man, but then he appears, and yes, he's absolutely gorgeous, and one of them dares her to go and get his phone number. She says, $5 if you can get his phone number. And so she takes the bet.
Hold it right there. Roll tape. Here is a scene.
You guys come here a lot?
No, just the last few weeks. I usually go to the one over on Harris with the big wood things, you know, and the slide across.
Yeah, we actually rent a house right around the corner from there on Ashforth. That ice cream truck never leaves. Such a nightmare.
Yeah, tell me about it.
You know, you're the first person here who's ever talked to me.
You make him nervous.
All right. I guess they don't see too many fathers here during the weekdays. You don't have to be polite. Go ahead and ask.
What?
You know, what the person who wears the pants in the family does for a living.
Oh. All right, what does your wife do?
She makes documentaries.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Like Michael Moore?
Like PBS.
Oh.
Now, you were watching that intently. Tell me how what you saw and thought through your actor's eyes.
I just was thinking, once again, I was thinking, God, that dialogue is just so good. The dialogue was so, just so natural. You know, you just feel like those two people are chit-chatting, having a conversation. Almost feels like it could have been improvised, but every line of dialogue was scripted for that particular scene. And we shot that in one day, and I was thinking, yeah, I remember this was the moment when both the kids threw up. And I'd said to them before we shot the scene, I said, OK, is there going to be breaks? Because, you know, swinging these three-year-olds for 3-4 hours, they are just going to be sick. And everyone was like, oh, no, I'm sure they'll be absolutely fine. One after the other. But I was also remembering how nervous I was shooting that scene because it's so pivotal. I mean, it's such an important scene. At the end of it, what happens, and I am going to tell what happens at the end of that scene, Sarah, she goes to him and she says, one of those women over there bet me $5 that I couldn't get your phone number. And then they realise that she doesn't have a pen, and then Sarah decides to take it one step further and she says, you know what would really freak them out? And they kiss. they kiss. And this is the first time these people have ever met in their lives. And it's the beginning of the rest of the movie. So I knew that nailing that scene was possibly more important than any other scene in the film, any of the nude scenes, any of the scenes towards the end where it becomes very highly charged and very emotional. That scene for me was absolutely everything, because it's the springboard to everything that happens every step of the way beyond that. It's the beginning of their erotic affair.
And they both know it.
And they both know it in many ways. And it's, you know, Sarah, from that point on, she becomes unleashed and unveiled. And this affair that she has with Brad reveals who she really is. It sort of gives her sense of self back again. You know, she hasn't felt sexy for years and years and years. She's never felt as in love with somebody as she does with this particular man. And, you know, those are really wonderful things. I mean, it's it completely transforms her.
There's a certain sense of not sure how they're doing, and there's a certain misgivings about it. Here I am. Mm-hmm. Should I be here? Is this okay? Mm-hmm. Yes? Am I right?
As an actor, you mean?
No, I mean, they're in words, in the script.
Yes, yes. Oh, yes.
You have two people, one in different times, saying, should we be doing this?
Yeah.
Rather than...
Yes, they do.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do, absolutely. But that's...
They've come to this moment yet.
Yeah. And he says to her, do you feel bad about this? And she just says,
no.
No. And he says, I do. I feel really bad. But in spite of those feelings, you know, it still happens, I think. And that is representative of some deep need in both of them as individuals. I think it's a more realized need on her part. But on his part, I don't think he realized how much of a great gaping emotional gap there was in his life, and how little he was actually being nourished in his own marriage, and how much indeed he needs this affair, he needs this relationship. And for Sarah, you know, just to do something that makes her feel completely different to any other moment that she's experienced in her life up until this point is so fantastic. So fantastic and so brave. And there were many things about her that I loved in that sense. You know, she's living in this place and everything that I was saying before, and she's stuck and trapped and etc. But she doesn't conform. She doesn't change herself or adapt herself in order to fit in more. She doesn't try and become one of these other playground women. She stays true to herself.
But she never was and would never be.
No, exactly. But I think that's a testament to her strength of character, because it's very easy when you're emotionally low and you're in an environment you don't feel you fit in. I mean, I remember this from my school days, you know. You sort of feel like, oh, well, maybe I should do my hair like they're doing their hair, and maybe they'll like me more. You know, there's something very naive about that, and weak, ultimately. And Sarah doesn't do that at all. She just remains who she is, and she doesn't put on lipstick just because the other mothers do, and she doesn't, you know, she doesn't stick to snack times in the same kind of routinely way as they do, and nor does she sort of bitch and bicker and gossip about everyone else in the town. She's just not that woman. She's
okay, so she has this experience.
In many ways.
She has this incredible experience. Mm-hmm. What's going to happen to her? Is she forever changed?
Yeah, I think she is forever changed, but I love the fact that you asked me that question simply because it means that you would actually kind of like to know what happens beyond that, and you care about her enough to want to know. And I think that's great, yeah, that this character sort of, in some way, people want to know what her life after this movie is. I think that her life is forever changed, and I think that she goes home with her little girl, realizing how much of a not only terrible parent she's been, but how much she has missed out on, how much she has been denying herself and denying her child in terms of happiness, just simply by looking into the eyes of that child and being the mother that the child needs for her to be. And I think she also knows that her chance of future happiness entirely rests in being with this little girl and making that her priority. Do I believe she goes home to her husband? No. I think she goes home for a while. She's probably going to figure out what to do for a week or two. And then, sure, she's going to leave. She may even move to another country. She'd probably steal a couple of his credit cards along the way as well. I wouldn't put it past her to say, you know what? You owe me.
Exactly. And I'm out of here.
Exactly.
There is, the interesting thing about him is that he's coming alive in lots of different ways. I mean, it's camaraderie with his buddies, mm-hmm. you know, playing football and doing these other things.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a sense that his life has begun to change, or he's more open. Mm-hmm. Don't you agree?
I do agree, and I think that...
He passes a test there with these guys who...
He does.
...didn't know whether he would measure up. They were cops.
Absolutely. I think that he, you know, Brad is a man who was, he may have wanted to deny it, but he was a stay-at-home dad. And, you know, his wife was putting pressure on him, his wife played by Jennifer Connelly, putting pressure on him to take the bar exam again. He'd failed it a couple of times before. And yet he just doesn't want to be a lawyer. He doesn't really know what he wants to be or who he is anymore. The one thing he does know is that he loves his son more than anything else in the world, and he is an absolutely wonderful dad. But I think Sarah makes him realise that he hasn't been loved like that for a very long time. And he hasn't felt so known by someone, certainly not a woman, in the way that she seems to know him. She seems to sort of unleash him in the same way that he unleashes her, and he gets, you know, to be a little bit more confident and to realize that he hasn't challenged himself in any way at all in his life for a long time.
Exactly.
Through the course of his marriage, and starts playing football again. This was something he did very successfully at college, and sort of makes friends with some of these guys who are around him all the time but who he doesn't really connect with, and they both give each other a little bit of life back, and that's very real, I think. About love and what happens when you fall in love with somebody is that you are given so much of your soul in a way that you've never been given it before, and in a way that perhaps you hadn't realized, you know, you had it inside of you, and it just takes a little, the turn of the key, and you know, all of those things are revealed.
All the King's Men is in theaters now, still is. Story of Huey Long. Little Children is in theaters now. Flushed Away will be in theaters November 3rd. And the holiday comes on December 8th.
Yep. Lots going on.
Thank you for coming.
You're welcome.
Great to see you.
Thank you. You too.
Todd Field is here. He is an actor, writer, producer, composer, and director. The first feature film he directed, In the Bedroom, earned 5 Academy Award nominations, including Best Picture. His second feature is called Little Children. A.O. Scott of the New York Times called it superb, a movie that is challenging, accessible, and hard to stop thinking about. Here is the trailer for the film. I am pleased to welcome Todd Field to this table for the first time. It is really a pleasure for me. Welcome.
Thank you.
First of all, I admire the fact that you were an actor and decided you wanted to direct. I mean, why did you do that?
Well, I think from the very beginning, I always wanted to make my own films. And... you know, there's a long history that of directors who have some kind of acting background, whether it's
right.
John Ford or, you know, Milos Forman or Elia Kazan or you know, take your pick. I think the idea of film actors or people that have some kind of public persona that's fairly strong doing it is something else. But, you know, I was a journeyman actor. I was fortunate to work with some very good directors, but I it was something I always wanted to do.
Yeah, yeah. You know? It's a cliche to say this, and a cliche question, but does it somehow make it easier for you to direct actors because you have been inside of an actor's head?
Probably. I mean, I know things that I appreciated as a performer myself and things that I didn't. But every actor is different and comes to it with a different point of view and an angle in terms of how they approach their work. So probably in certain cases it's very helpful. In other cases it may be completely irrelevant.
This is an adaptation from a book.
Mm.
Hard to? I mean, tell me how you approached it.
Well, I was fortunate in that I was able to adapt the book with the novelist,
right,
Tom Parada, who also had written some screenplays. So he came at it as a screenwriter who happened to have written the novel. And that was an incredible opportunity. One, because he is a writer, and he, you know, he's either writing essays or book reviews for the New York Times or a piece for the New Yorker or a novel, and he's used to deadlines. And that's a very important thing in a writing partner, you know. And also, you know, he had created these characters, and so it was a, you know, who better to talk to?
Yeah. And so, I mean, how would you do the process? So how did it work out? I mean,
well, we started talking about an approach, and Tom had some ideas in terms of different things that would be germane strictly to the script, as did I, and we got together. He lives outside of Cambridge. We got together in a hotel room in Boston and just sort of
You live
hold
in Maine,
up.
He lives in Cambridge, and so you could work it out.
Right,
yeah. And you just hold up and work it out and talk about it? And
yeah, we spent 2 or 3 days just sort of talking about maybe a way in, and then we just got down to writing and walking it.
Writing it together?
Mm-hmm.
How difficult is that, though? I mean,
in this case, it wasn't difficult at all, because you get up and you start to play with each other. You start to dance with each other and play scenes. And
what about this? Does this work here?
Does this work here? Does this work there? Wait a minute, I have an idea. Just let me get it down. Okay, let's read it. That doesn't work. Let's try something else. I'm going to talk at this time. You write it. You talk at this time. I'll get it down. But it's a very fluid thing, you know. And it's also a lot less lonely having someone in the room with you.
Because writing can be the most.
Oh, it's yeah. It's a very
painful thing
painful,
you can possibly
painful
do.
Thing.
People talk about in the bedroom and this, and they look at the casting, they say, you know, that is also a skill that you obviously have. You take in the bedroom and Tom Wilkinson, you talk about this, and Kate. Tell me how you approached it for this.
Well, I try never to think about actors at all until a script is set, because I don't want to be reductive with the characters. And probably if I'm thinking about a particular actor, I'm being reductive with that actor, too, because it's being informed, that impulse, by work that I've seen previous that they've done.
Sure.
But that's a very, very important moment, because the actors that you invite to come and make a film with you will be the most meaningful collaborators you're going to have, period. It's not going to be anybody else but the actors.
Mike Nichols once said here to me, the thing he most wants to see from an actor is be surprised.
Yes.
You know?
Yes. And so, you know, with these actors, I was very blessed. You know, the first person that I approached was Kate Winslet. I had seen her. I was probably the only person in the world that had never seen Kate Winslet. I certainly knew the name, but when Tom and I finished the script, Michel Gondry's film was coming out, and I went into the theater knowing nothing, And this woman came on screen, and I leaned in, and I thought, who is that? It's an American actress, but who is that? And then there's this scene where she's in this public transportation, and she leans over to Jim Carrey, and she just goes, bam, and she hits him, and I, oh my God, she's crazy. She's nuts. What's she gonna do next? And I found myself so off balance with that performance, and so drawn in by that instantly. And when the credits came up, I said, oh my God, that's Kate Winslet.
Who you'd heard about but didn't know.
Right. And so there was never anyone else considered for that part. I went and tried to meet her immediately, and I was thrilled when she said yes, because I don't know who else.
Did she say yes after what? Did you have to convince her that about anything?
I called her agent, and her agent said, let me call you back. And she called back about 5 minutes later and said, she wants to meet you. Can you meet her in this abandoned office building on the west side of Los Angeles where she's preparing something? I said, okay. And this was 3 days before the Academy Awards, and she was nominated that year for Eternal Sunshine. I go into this office building. There she is. She's sitting alone in this empty room, just madly going through the novel of All the King's Men, and she'd been there. I could tell she'd been there for hours. And I said, "Are you just beginning this?" She said, "No. It's a small part, and I'm almost finished. But there's something here. There's something here. I know I'm missing it." And I thought, here's this actor. They're nominated for an Oscar. They're not going out and being photographed. They're not going out and picking up all the gift bags. Okay. They're sitting here, sweating, trying to get the last bit of anything that they possibly can out of a part.
And not a major part.
And that was a very good way to meet Kate, and completely consistent with how I experienced her throughout the film.
And you said, would you? And she said, yes?
I said, would you? I left her the script because I like to go to an actor and have them know that I want them, I admire you, and I don't distribute my material. So I gave her the script, and then I left, and then I waited, and then she called me and said, she said at the time, I have some things I have to work out, and she called me and said, I'll do it, I just have to figure out my family life, because she wasn't supposed to be working for 6 months or a year, and her husband Sam Mendes was in post on his film, which was supposed to be in London. So the whole family kind of turned themselves on their head for her to do this. And Sam moved his post to New York, and they were switching off childcare. And she really, went to a great effort to do this.
Whenever she sets foot in the room, I look forward to it. She's that compelling and interesting, as well as beautiful and sort of smart.
Well, she. She is an ideal person to work with, aside from her skill as an actress, because she brings in her wake the most unbelievable enthusiasm. And you can have the most talented person in the world, but enthusiasm counts at least equally. And
I would take a B talent with an A passion and enthusiasm, rather than having an A talent with a B enthusiasm.
So, as would I.
Would you?
Yes, I would.
Absolutely.
Always. Because enthusiasm can, extraordinary things come out of enthusiasm.
Yeah. And you may not get, if you got B enthusiasm, you may not get the A talent.
Exactly.
It's not going to come out.
Yes.
Unless they really are passionate about giving it to you.
Yes.
Take Patrick Wilson, tell me about him.
Patrick Wilson, that was a very tough role. Both these roles were very tough to imagine, because they could come off as very shallow characters and two-dimensional characters. And I was looking for someone like the rest of Hollywood, who basically was a fantastic actor, but also was a movie star, because he's sort of objectified by all of these people all these women in the film as being this sort of movie star, but a movie star from my childhood, like a Newman or a Redford or someone like that. And I thought, where am I going to find this person? I mean, of course, it would be great to find someone like that. And I mentioned this to Kate, and she said, well, do you know about Patrick Wilson? I said, no. She said, you have to see him. So I looked at Mike Nichols' film, and said, oh my gosh, this. this man is extraordinary, and asked him to do it, and you know, thank God he did.
There are always literary references in your films. Madame Bovary, here in the bedroom, Blake was quoted nonchalantly over a poker game.
Well, you know, in terms of in a poker game in the bedroom, you know, there's unexpected things that you find in your neighbors in Maine. They're extraordinarily well-read, strong political minds. There's three local newspapers, and everybody reads every one of them. And so that was really kind of, that was where that idea came from. In terms of the Flaubert reference, that's strictly from the novel, and that was Tom's. And that's this character, Sarah Pierce, who has these, you know, the sort of, she's a sort of fallen woman of letters. You know, she has these aspirations.
For what?
To have a literary life, perhaps, to be a journalist or a writer or, you know, something that she has squashed in this impulse to have a child that she's not really sure why she made that decision.
Is there anything else that people thinking about in the bedroom and thinking about this little children that they would look at and say, I can tell this is the same director?
I don't know.
The theme, the characters, you know. Let's argue along the lines of, you know, somebody could say that's a Woody Allen movie. Could somebody look at this and say that's a Todd Field movie? You only have made two, but...
Well, I don't know. From every film I made, you know, from when I attended the American Film Institute as a fellow there, through these two feature films, I approach every story or every film in a very practical way. I'm hopefully not too conscious of why I'm approaching it a certain way. I imagine there's some consistency simply because it's the same person doing it. But I don't know. I mean, as you said, it's only the second feature, and you know, I always think we're in a really interesting time right now, and a peculiar time, which is you go back and you look at somebody like John Ford. You know, he made 30 movies, big westerns, getting stronger and stronger with that muscle before you would ever say, ah, that's a John Ford picture, or clearly his ability had caught up with his imagination. And yet now we, you know, young filmmaker comes out, we make one film, it's great that it's embraced, you know, and but then you make the other film and suddenly it's held under this, you know, microscope.
Right.
And you've only just begun. It's a very different way to look at someone's work.
Your own personal relationship. Your wife is your creative partner.
She was, you know, very involved with the making of In the Bedroom in almost every possible capacity, whether it was the sets or the script or anything else. And even on Little Children, she walked my locations with me, and really within a day had given me absolute gold and refused to let me stop working on the script until she thought I wasn't, you know, that I wasn't faking it. And she's a pretty good detector that way. In fact, probably the one central idea of matriarchy that is in Tom's novel and that runs through every single relationship, you know, even if it's a genderless form of matriarchy, but the opposite of the other element in that book, which is judgment. But the idea of being kind and not judgmental and turning the other cheek or possibly trying to walk in someone else's shoes is actualized in one central speech that Phyllis Somerville gives to Jackie Earle Haley between you know, Ronnie and his mother. And that speech was not in the script and was really found very, very late. And that's really Serena's. I mean, she said, you're missing something here, and you're missing the central idea, and this is what it is. And she literally just kind of, boom, gave it to me.
And what's in the speech?
It's the speech where May is trying to explain to Ronnie that...
May being the mother of Ronnie, being the alleged sexual offender.
Right, where she says, you're a miracle, Ronnie. you're a miracle. We're all miracles.
Because he had no sense of self-worth.
Because he has no sense of self-worth. He's completely full of self-loathing. And that was a very profound thing to for her to realize. And it's, you know, the film is kind of unmanageable without it for me.
Mentors. I read that Stanley Kubrick was a mentor. Or you just drew from him because you were in Eyes Wide Shut.
I was. I wouldn't say Stanley was a mentor. I would say Stanley was a very important...
Had an impact?
Yes, certainly. I mean, Stanley had an impact on me before I ever worked with him. And every director that I've worked with has been someone that I've tried to pay attention to because... It's a great opportunity to be able to observe filmmakers at work and see how they come at their work. That as a filmmaker, you don't really have the opportunity to do. We don't visit each other and on our sets for weeks and months at a time. And as an actor, that was a pretty terrific opportunity. I work with some terrific directors.
Thank you, Todd. Congratulations on the film.
All right, thank you.
Pleasure.